Hi there, good afternoon everyone, and welcome to this online class on the analysis and interpretation of financial and non-financial information. I'm your lecturer, Masum Ali. Some of you would know me from a lot of my previous work that's been done. I've received a lot of positive feedback from these classes so far. I'm very happy that you guys are enjoying them. I do think I need to take this opportunity to apologize for a bit of a technical issue which we had. So this was supposed to be an online class, and unfortunately that didn't quite happen, but it was supposed to be an online live class, and yeah, due to some technical issues that didn't quite come across, and unfortunately we've had to improvise a bit, but we're making the best of a difficult situation. Speaking of difficult situations, I hope that you guys are all safe and well wherever you guys are. Definitely want to be into keeping safe at this point in time. With the coronavirus, it has impacted a lot of people. I know, not just in terms of finances. I think that's the one area that gets a lot of spotlight and a lot of attention, but mentally as well. A lot of students, a lot of people in general that I've been speaking to have, you know, complained about being frustrated, very negative, despondent, those sort of things. And I just want to take this opportunity to sort of tell you guys that you guys need to get your mindset in the right place, because if you're not going to do that, you're really going to struggle and you can make it harder for yourself. And that's not what you want, right? CCA is difficult enough as it is, and you don't need anything making it even more difficult. So anyway, this presentation is going to be very much to the point, because I want you guys to actually understand what it is that you guys are expected to do. So it's not going to be like a detailed undergraduate sort of step-by-step type of thing. However, it is going to be sufficiently detailed enough to ensure that you guys are able to pass and that you guys know the tips and, you know, a few tricks and strategies that you guys seem to miss when it comes to tests and exams, and it costs you guys easy marks, and but you guys are throwing it away because you guys either don't know about these things, or you guys know about it and forget about it because of either exam pressure and things like that, which is normal. But all of you guys who have attended my lectures before will know that I place a lot of emphasis on mark scoring and exam technique, because ultimately, I think the technical stuff a lot of us know. And obviously, that is important, but you need to be able to execute it. You need to be able to put it on paper. And the moment you can't do that, and the moment you cannot demonstrate to the marker that you understand what's been done, you're going to be losing marks. And that's the last thing that you want, right? Okay. So continuing with the lecture, I always like to start off with a motivational quote, and this motivational quote right here says, it's one of my favorite ones, right? It says, "Don't wish it were easier, wish you were better," right? And this is so true. You know, CCA just doesn't get easier. You know, some people tend to have this false illusion or assume that, okay, somehow the year ends up making itself easier as you go along, or that, you know, things just miraculously become better, or that whichever university you're at, they gonna somehow, you know, just ease off the pressure. And it just doesn't work that way. I wish it did. But in some ways, I actually don't wish that it did, because at the end of the day, you want to be able to be challenged and get the best out of yourself. And if it's going to be too easy, then you won't be doing that. So it is important that you bear in mind that you just need to focus on improving what you do, you know. And you'll find a lot of students that have passed, they'll never say that, no, well, you know, we passed this year because, well, this year got easier, so that's why. No, it's going to be that from not knowing how to do something, you sort of learned how to do it. So don't wait for UNISA to make concessions. Don't wait for all these types of things and hope that, okay, an exam entrance will be slashed to 30% or something like that, or that they're going to make the exam easier because of the coronavirus and some sort of thing like that. That's wishful thinking, and it's not the type of mentality that you want to be having. Okay, so please don't make that sort of mistake, all right? You can get better. This is your attempt at getting better. So make sure that you do whatever you need to do in order to improve yourself and step up to that next level, And you have the ability to do it. We all have the ability to do it. It's just whether you do it or not. And sometimes when you, you know, feel like you're going to get a break or, you know, things are just going to ease up, you don't invest in yourself. And that's a critical mistake, right? Okay, our agenda, pretty short, right? So it's ratios, interpretation of ratios, exam technique. Other questions? Well, these will be answered via Facebook, obviously, because of the fact that this was unable to be a live session. And we will, you know, they are to conclude. So as you can see, very much straightforward and directly to the point. I don't want this to be a very long, winded lecture. It's not going to be beneficial to anyone to do that way. I want you guys to get the full value out of it. So with regards to administrative issues, well, these are more applicable to the live events. So I don't really think that we need to waste time on it. So we can just skip ahead to the next slide and we can get into ratio analysis, right? So now our study approach for ratio analysis right now. This is something which a lot of students unfortunately get wrong. And the problem is that when you start studying and you've already started off the wrong foot or started off the wrong note, what happens is that it's very difficult to correct it halfway down the line, because what do you start doing after that? Now, this is something which is important for you guys to understand, right? You need to start off with a proper foundation. You cannot just jump into it and sort of shortcut it. And this is one of the reasons that so many students actually fail a lot of the other sections. People try and skimp through the information or rather skim through the information. And, you know, it just doesn't get done. You know, or the work doesn't get covered the way it should be getting covered. And that's not what that's not what you need to be doing. That's not the mindset you need to have, right? So the first thing you need to do is learn the theory contained within your prescribed books. I know some of you are not into theory. You know, you guys, you guys sort of shy away from the theory, right? And that's a bit unfortunate in terms of the fact that you guys, you know, in CTA, then you need to sort of understand that it's not just about learning a formula off. You need to understand why you're calculating a particular formula. And you need to understand the context behind it. And you're only going to get that by knowing the theory behind it. Now, sometimes in undergrad, you get away with it, right? So, you know, don't make that now sort of the norm, and don't think that, okay, because you've done it in undergrad that you're going to, you know, manage to do that post-grad. It's a mistake that a lot of people make, and it has bad consequences, right? So understand the formulas. That's another thing. So you've got the formulas. Don't just memorize them. Understand what it is. What is the inputs in that formula? What are they? How are you getting these amounts? What are they? You know, what information are you actually getting from them? Okay, so you can't just say that you've swatted it off and now you know the formula, but you don't understand what you're calculating. And that's where your interpretation suffers, because you guys don't understand exactly what you've calculated, because you don't understand the formula. You've just memorized it and put two numbers there and, you know, gotten to a figure. That's not how you want to be doing it, right? And then do questions to gain more exposure, because obviously you need to practice exam technique and you have to do questions to sort of see how you can be, you know, challenged and how you can be challenged and how you can actually receive information in many different ways, you know. So that's the thing that you need to also understand. So yeah, that's just something that I wanted you guys to understand with regards to the study approach, right? That's very important. Okay, that's not an area which I take lightly. I really put a lot of emphasis on it. I'm sort of trying to think of a way to really emphasize how important this is, right? Because in CTA, you really need to. So, yeah, just make sure that your study approach is correct. Okay. Now, we obviously with the analysis of financial statements, there's a lot of different types of financial statements analysis. You can get horizontal analysis and vertical analysis. You know, those sort of things are also there. Trend analysis is also there. So it's not just ratio analysis. That's the one thing I want you guys to understand. But the thing is that we do predominantly work on ratio analysis. And ratio analysis by definition, this definition from accountingtools.com says that ratio analysis is the comparison of the line items in the financial statements of a business. Ratio analysis is used to evaluate a number of issues with an entity, such as liquidity, efficiency of operations, and profitability. And these are the five categories into which your ratios technically or typically fall, right? So your profitability ratios, your liquidity ratio, solvency, activity, and your market ratios, right? So very important to understand these ratios or the categories into which these ratios fall. Why is this the case? Because when you get a question, some of them might ask you to comment on the profitability of the company, right? So you'll go there, you look at the financial statements, and in all likelihood, they'll give you a set of financial statements, right? And it's not enough just to say, okay, the company's made a profit of, you know, 1 million rand during the year. What does that mean? Is that a good profit? You know, what does it say about the company? You know, I mean, it's made 1 million rand. However, should it have actually made more than 1 million rand given the assets and liabilities and, you know, the resources which it has at its disposal? So that's where ratio analysis will come in and actually give you a better reflection of what that profitability is like in terms of percentage, in terms of a ratio. Just to say that, okay, hang on, yeah, you know, I know this 1 million rand might be good, might not be good. You know, for example, if the profit was 1 million rand, but the sales are like 500 million rand, then yeah, you know, you'd feel 1 million rand for 500 million rand sales is a bit low. So do you understand the thinking along which or the line along which your thinking needs to be? So that's something which you need to really bear in mind. So they will ask you questions in that sort of way. They're not going to ask you, you know, calculate the current ratio. Very unlikely you're going to get a question like that. You'd be a very lucky person to actually get that. Okay. So starting off with our first one. Okay. Okay, so the profitability ratios are those ratios which are used to measure and evaluate the ability of a company to generate income relative to its revenue. And they show how well a company utilizes its assets to produce profits and to produce value to its shareholders. So that's not, because you guys can memorize that and you guys can look at that. But the main thing which I want you guys to take away is actually what the purpose of these profitability ratios is. Okay. So let's think about that just for a minute, right? You're trying to actually look at, based on your sales, if you just look at these things, you see how everything is really revolving around your sales. The first two ratios, right, are looking at, you know, expressing something in proportion to your net sales. Right? So your gross margin ratio, it's, you know, comparing the ratio between your gross profit and your net sales, so operating margin ratio, operating income to your net sales. You can get anything else also if the margin, anything that's a margin ratio would be over your net sales. So if it was an other income margin ratio, it would be an other income over your net sales. Okay, so that's a very easy trick to remember and to use when you want to actually analyze or when you're studying these sort of ratios, right? It's not difficult. I've included why, you know, or the use of the ratio So just have a read at that 4 minutes. Okay, so looking at our, I would assume that you guys, took the time to read this. And at the end of the day, okay, I haven't, included worked examples in these, right? So you guys can consult on those things, right? But I wanted you guys to sort of pick up, on certain points on here, right? So the first one is, if you look at your gross margin, compare the gross profit of a company to its net sales to show how much of profit a company makes after it pays the cost of its goods sold. And then if you look at this, the operating margin ratio, it says that the operating margin ratio compares the operating income of a company to its net sales to determine the operating efficiency. Okay, so this is obviously different to this, right? This operating margin is looking at your operating income. So this is after your operating expenses, etc., have been you're taking into account, you're looking at your other expenses, etc., having been taken into account at this point, right? Then we're looking at our return on assets ratio. It's basically just our net income over our total assets. That's important, right? Total assets. And it's just looking at how efficiently the company has used its assets to generate a profit. Okay, so obviously you would expect that if the asset base was higher, our income would be higher. This can sometimes get a bit, manipulated, but remember your total assets will be depreciating over a period of time. So over a period of time, you'd expect this ratio to be increasing anyway, right? Because if our total assets was 1 million rand and we are depreciating over 5 years, you'd expect next year will be 800,000, then 200, then 600,000, et cetera, et cetera. Even if the net income remains the same, you're going to be having a okay. So you're going to be having an increasing ratio, right? The same thing applies with the return on equity ratio. As shareholders' equity changes, however, this you would not anticipate there to be, too volatile a change. However, it can sort of get manipulated, if the company issues shares, buys back shares. So you need to remember these things and take these things into account as well. These are small points just to remember. Right? So at this point, we're just looking at calculating the ratios. Okay, now we're looking at our liquidity ratios. These are the more common ones, right? And the liquidity ratios basically are used to evaluate the ability of a company to pay off both its current liabilities as they become due, as well as the long-term liabilities as they become current. So we're basically looking at how much cash the company has and how easy the company can actually convert its assets into cash so that it can have sufficient cash and cash equivalents in order to pay off its debts, etc., or its current liabilities. So that's a simple enough principle to understand. I don't think that there should be any difficulties in that regard. But these are very common ones, right? So looking at our liquidity ratios, we've got our current ratio, which is our current assets or our current liabilities, and it's just looking at the ability of the company to pay off its current liabilities with its current assets, right? You guys would be knowing this, you would be remembering this, not difficult at all. not going to spend too much of time on this. Asset test ratio is your current assets less your inventories all over your current liabilities. So basically the same thing as our current current ratio, just including, just excluding our inventories from our current assets. Okay. The reason is that we look at the most liquid assets which we have. And the thing is that with inventories, remember, they're not, although they are liquid, they're not immediately in a liquid form, meaning that we have to still sell them. We need to convert them into cash. Okay, so we need to make a sale that can take, it wouldn't typically take more than a year. Other inventories would not be a current asset. But, you know, in general terms, it still needs to be sold before we can actually get it into a, before we can actually call it an asset. Okay. And then days sales outstanding. This is actually an often overlooked one. And it's basically our accounts receivable all over our total credit sales times number of days in sales, right? So this ratio refers to the average capacity, or rather the average number of days that it takes a company to collect payment after it makes a sale. Obviously, we want this to be as small as possible. The reason, now let's look at it in terms of liquidity. If this is a very high number, then what's happening is that it suggests that the company is taking longer to actually recover the money which is owed to it. So it makes a sale and say it was 60 days. And then, you know, that's how we calculate the ratio and it's 60 days. That's sort of telling us that the company is taking 2 months to recover. So if we make a sale today, we're only going to get our money back in 2 months. That does put us in a bit of pressure, because the thing is that we have to make payments on a monthly basis, for example, you know, to our suppliers, to everybody else, you know, to our service providers. So do you see now, for that type of thing, we are now going to potentially run into a liquidity position or a problem, because at the end of the day, we are receiving our money way too late. We're receiving it much later than we should. Okay. So those three are the most common those are the most common ones that you need to just be mindful of. Okay. If in an exam they ask you to comment on the liquidity of a of the company, make sure that you've included these ratios. Okay. Definitely the first two. They will never ask it to you just in a direct way. They're always gonna ask it to you in an indirect way. They comment on the liquidity of the company. You know, what does the do you think the company would be able to repay its current liabilities? You know, that's that type of thing. They're always going to take it from that angle. Okay. Now we're looking at our solvency ratios. Solvency ratios are those ratios used to evaluate the ability of a company to pay off its long-term debts. Okay, so similar to our current, rather to our liquidity ratios, but just looking at our long-term debt paying ability. Okay, so looking at our debt to equity ratios, our total debt to our total equity, basically just giving us the proportion that debt bears in relation to the total equity which we have. And note that it's total debt, so it includes both your long-term and your short-term debt. Okay, that's an important one. Some people or some students definitely exclude this, the short-term debt for some reason. It does not, even though the solvency ratio itself is looking at the ability to pay off its long-term debts, we're still looking at total debts in this, right? Debt to assets ratio, similar principle to the debt to equity ratio, however, just looking at the ability of the debt of the entity to pay off its debt, or looking at how many or what percentage of its debt is financed through its assets, or rather what percentage of its assets is financed through its debt, rather. So, you know, obviously, you want this to be as low a percentage as possible. And it's going to really depend on the capital structure of the company. This would give you a good indication of what the capital structure of a company is, just by the way. And you guys will look at, we'll see that when we actually do, you know, more work on capital structure. Right. Interest cover ratio. This is just the ability of the company to meet its interest payments. So we're looking at our operating income over our interest expense. Obviously, the higher the number, the priorities for us, right? So this will be from the income statement. So just look at your EBIT over your income, or your, over your interest expense in the income statement. So therefore, it's not interest actually paid, but it's your interest expense per your income statement, right? Okay, now moving on to our next section. With the activity ratios, these are looking at how efficiently the operations are being conducted. So the activity ratios are also called our efficiency ratios. Very simple to actually understand. So we're looking at our average collection period, inventory turnover, and accounts receivable turnover. I'm not going to spend much time on these ones. I'd rather get into our exam technique and our interpretation. So you guys can read this from the slide. They don't really commonly get asked, to be perfectly honest. So it's good to know these. I mean, they not that they don't get asked at all, but I would say from here, the inventory turnover period is quite good. They wouldn't ask it to you in a direct way, as I've said. Okay, so if you know the formula here, and you are able to actually apply the formula, you wouldn't really need to find much difficulty. These are not, I think that there's much more scope for examination on your liquidity and your solvency ratios, right? Now, looking at your efficiency ratios or your activity ratios, I think the inventory turnover one is a particularly important one. And the one thing I want to draw is this, that the average inventory, so it's cost of goods sold, which is your cost of sales of your average inventory. This is typically going to be your inventory at the beginning of the year plus the inventory at the end of the year divided by 2, okay? Some questions don't do that way. Some just use the inventory at the end of the year, but it's technically more correct to use your average inventory. So just, you know, be aware of that one. But other than that, I wouldn't be too bothered by these ratios at the moment. I think you guys would be sufficiently covered if you looked at your profitability, liquidity, and your solvency ratios, right? The market ratios are also quite important. Okay, so these are very common ones, and actually, with what's happening actually right now, which is quite topical with the coronavirus, etc., I would think that market ratios are going to be a very hot topic. So I would suggest that you guys, you know, make some effort on going through these ones. They're quite easy, right? So if you look at our price earnings ratio, it's our market price per share, which would easily be given to you all over our annual earnings per share. And the PE ratio is just basically used as a guide to give the relative value of the company. So it's just the higher the PE ratio, the higher the expected value perceived value of the company. Okay. So we would want to see that. Now, here it says it provides an indication of whether a share is overvalued or undervalued. Obviously, in some cases where the market price is very high, it would indicate that the price-earnings ratio, it would give rise to a higher price-earnings ratio. So people would feel, okay, well, the share is overpriced, but there may be factors for that. So for example, the market may feel, well, even though this company isn't making millions and maybe the earnings per share is quite low, we feel that this company, or the market feels that the company has, you know, big prospects, you know. So this is something which would give an indication. So a higher PE ratio would give an indication of that. And you need to make sure that you understand that it's just a market expectation. It does not really actually mean an actual value for the company. It's just what the market is reacting like. Earnings per share, very easy one. It's your net income. That's your preference dividends. If there are any, make sure you check for this. all of your weighted average number of ordinary shares outstanding, right? Ordinary shares, again, another important one. It would be very straightforward in a financial management question. Obviously, in if you're doing accounting, it would be much more complex than this. But for the purposes of financial management, it would be quite straightforward. And it's just giving an indication of the earnings that I anticipated from these shares. Okay, so obviously the higher the number, the better. If we have something like 5 rand per share, we might feel, well, okay, for every share that I have, I feel like the company is going to generate 5 rand of earnings. Do you think that's good or not? I mean, that's going to depend on the industry. And, you know, obviously you would be comparing it to other companies because some might have an earnings per share of 20 rand per share. Some might have an earnings per share of 100 rand per share. Obviously, the lower the weighted average number of shares outstanding, the higher the earnings per share is going to be. So that's something to bear in mind as well. Dividends per share is the annual dividends paid all over the number of shares in issued. So obviously, shareholders would want this to be as high as possible because it's indicating that, well, we're getting a healthy dividend for each share that we have. However, the company needs to have a bit of a balancing act with this. But, you know, a signaling theory, if you remember your the content on this, the higher the dividend, a dividend gives the market an indication that, the company is profitable. It gives a positive signal to the markets. So companies would typically want this to be as high as possible. They don't need to necessarily pay more dividends, but they could just reduce the number of shares in issue. Okay, so now looking at our exam technique. Right, your reading time. Your reading time is very important, right? You need to sort of dissect your information. So time management is going to be a critical factor here, right? Your reading time is going to talk a lot in terms of these sort of things, right? So if you're looking at our reading time, you want to highlight your ratios. I wouldn't think it's a bad idea to calculate some of these ratios, and I would think that you should calculate some of them during your reading time. Also, just bear in mind of comparative information. These types of things need to be understood as well, because that will be given to you in the question. Norms might be given to you in the question. A comparative industry, comparative year, which would obviously be your previous year. So look for all of these questions in your reading time, and this will help with your time management. In terms of what can be asked, you're never going to get asked a direct question on this. They would ask you to comment on the financial position or the liquidity, etc., of the company. So it's always going to be integrated with a theory question. What I've seen is they sort of ask you to support, or they'll say discuss why the company, or discuss the liquidity of the company, support your answer with calculations, or provide calculations to support your answer. When they tell you something like that, then you would expect that there's going to be a ratio analysis that you need to do. Maybe the liquidity rate, one of your liquidity ratios, your current ratio, for example, or your solvency ratios, etc. Okay, how to answer? Well, on a straightforward thing, you would basically state for a fact what is the liquidity ratio. So if you've calculated a current ratio, for example, and you've said it's 2:1, you would say the current ratio is 2:1, then you'd see whether it's healthy or not. Okay. So the current ratio is 2:1, whether it's healthy or not. Afterwards, you'll say, okay, the norm, if you know the norm, or the norm is given in the question, is this. And then you will basically then conclude on using that, okay, that, yeah, based on this, it's above the norm, it's below the norm, and, is the company doing better or not than what the norm is given. Then you need to look at a competitor or another company in the same industry, or, maybe a year-on-year comparison. They will give you some sort of comparative information, and that's when you will now do your comparison there. And you'll say, okay, fine, the company's current ratio last year was 3:1, it's 2:1 this year, it's declined. and then give possible reasons for that. You know, the company, its current assets got less for some reason, its current liabilities got more for some reason. That's sort of the lines that you want to be answering the question. Okay. Now, interpretation is very important because you need to be understanding why you're doing what you're doing. Okay, so it's not enough. If you have a ratio that's given to you, okay, then what you need to do is you need to understand the information that's provided. So it's not just about, okay, you've been given information and, you know, now what do you do with it? And that's where students often fall short. Most of the marks are actually in the interpretation of the question rather than in the actual calculation of the ratios. So what I will suggest is that you guys don't just learn the ratio, you actually understand the ratios. And you guys need to spend some time going through past papers to actually see how UNISA wants you to answer. Generally, they want you to use a lot of information in the question, and interpretation will require the use of, you know, current events as well. So, for example, if the current ratio is low, say, okay, fine, the current assets have decreased due to something, look for information in the question that gives you, that supports your answer, right? You need to understand that. So, if the current assets have decreased, why have they decreased? What has given rise to this decrease? If there isn't information in the question, think of current events, you know, the coronavirus, for example. How is that going to impact on the company? A lot of companies would be impacted in an adverse way when we think about it. And, you know, it's not something that's going to be in your textbook, but it's going to be something that you need to know and to be aware of. Okay, so these are the types of things which you guys need to understand. It's the types of things which get examined. It's not difficult. I mean, we haven't done any calculations on it because you guys are expected to know how to do the calculations. And the calculations, to be perfectly honest, are really easy. The marks are coming in the interpretation of these, right? So if you can interpret these ratios that you've calculated, that's what's going to score your marks. And you need to provide a lot of information from the question itself. A lot of information is contained within the question. And don't forget about current events. Current events play a big role. You would be surprised as to just how many students forget about these sort of things. And then it does impact their marks. So you might not get the ratio correct. It's not about getting the ratio correct. But if your interpretation is correct, you're still going to get these marks. So that's what you guys need to do. And that's what you guys need to be focusing on, okay? Right, so if you guys have any other questions, I would suggest that you guys actually try a few questions and then you consult via our Facebook page. That would actually work a lot better. So if you guys want to, what you guys can do is you can do a few questions and send them through and we'll actually mark them and then we'll give you feedback on them. We're more than happy to do that. I think that actually works a lot better than the online, just, you know, merely doing the webinar. So please do it that way. Learning the principles is to use, but we've highlighted the important ratios that you guys need to know and let your analysis revolve around these things, okay? Obviously, there wouldn't be any other questions. We will be trying to see if we can get this live streaming working, you know, as soon as possible. If not, we will just be doing pre-recordings and sending these through. But however, we will let you know about this, you know, as we get information from our side as well. Other than that, thank you very much for your time, for your patience. We hope you've taken some value out of this webinar. As I said, please send us your questions. We will mark them. We'll get back to you. If you guys have any other questions, we're more than happy to answer them. Okay, but please just do get in touch with us. We want you guys to do well. And really, this is an easy topic. I mean, it wouldn't count for a lot of marks in the paper, to be perfectly honest, not in a test scenario. But at this point, I mean, any marks which you can get, which are easy marks, you definitely don't want to be losing out on. Okay. So, yeah, please send your queries through to us, your questions through to us. We'll mark them, and then we'll work on you guys on, you know, getting guys to a passing grade and making sure that test two goes a lot better. Other than that, all the best with your preparation. Stay safe and good luck with the rest of your studies.